All across America, we've got sheriffs shaking their heads and proclaiming, "I'm just doing my job," as they interject themselves into private property matters, even in non-judicial foreclosure states. How does it all work? Well, today we're going to focus on a Maryland property, 1926 Wilson Point Road, out there in Baltimore, with some background. That background includes the Baltimore courts and government snooping around my journal page when there's nothing new there. But what is new is the fact that there's an attorney subject to disciplinary proceedings working at the U.S. Patent and Trademark Office who keeps searching my journal page as well. Why was Matthew McDowell working on foreclosure cases with John Shapiro and Burson when he works full-time at the U.S. Patent Office? Does it have to do with the fact that the Patent Office has granted a patent to the banking industry to securitize failed 1003 mortgage loan applications? I wouldn't bet against it. Police and thieves in the street. Meanwhile, here comes the realtor, now that 1926 has been summarily foreclosed on. We're going to delve into that more in a minute. But for now, just know that he's trying to put some lipstick on that pig and move it along quickly through a silent internet auction only. The better to keep our cameras away from it. You know, move along, there's nothing to see here, right? But there's plenty to see, including the Stewart title memorandum warning its title insurance producers not to write for Thomas P. Dorr, who was the original foreclosing attorney on 1926 Wilson Point. Dorr got them to change that, though, because of his connections. Most likely because he's, you know, a senator. His law partner is a senator. Now, how do I know all of this? Because I used to write for Stewart Title myself, and I have my connections. So keep watching for more on the attempts to censor this information from the American public and the dirty judge involved, Judge Micky Norman. Dirty and deceitful and dishonest. Shouldn't be on the bench. Stay tuned.
This is Jim Botluck. Could I help you?
Hi, Attorney Botluck, this is Christopher King. How are you?
I'm fine.
All right. Yeah, we spoke briefly a couple of weeks ago, you know, regarding
the ongoing
Matthew McDowell and John Burson hearings and such, and the you know, rampant foreclosure fraud that's going on. But I have an issue for you that I'm not comfortable with, because I have some associates who provided me recordings from those hearings, and they were told that those copies are for a limited purpose of verification of testimony only, and that any broadcast and or copies made of an electronic recording is strictly prohibited by law and administrative order of the court. But I find that to be unconstitutional. I mean, these are public hearings. The public is welcome to attend, right?
They're public hearings, yes. It was a public hearing. There were several members of the public present.
Right. So, I mean, isn't that antithetical to the First Amendment? I mean, I was a First Amendment attorney. That was, my scholarship was all in the First Amendment. And I'm having a hard time understanding why he would get a message or what administrative rule is prohibiting the reproduction of these, you know, of these tapes.
I don't know. I don't have any. I am aware that rule exists, but I don't. I've never looked into that issue of constitutionality of that.
Right. Yeah. Well. I mean. I mean. Where can we go from here? Because I intend to publish these, and I can't think of any logical or lawful reason why I should be prohibited from publishing these. If you're into eradicating the injustice and ethical issues, you know, we need to have the weight of the public behind us so that they can be aware of these proceedings. And I just, when I post this, I don't want any legal flack, because, as you know, I will sue.
Well, I can't give you any legal advice. We're not allowed to give anybody legal advice. So you can, you know, either do the research yourself and pursue it, or hire an attorney to do that. But I really can't help you on that. And I just
don't know
anything about whether there's any cases out there that address that issue of whether court proceedings, you know, in essence, recordings of court proceedings, what lawful restrictions can be put on them. It's an interesting issue. I just don't know.
Sure.
I don't have any sense on what the law is with that.
Right. Because there's even within this case, there's an issue where I believe George McDermott was present, and he there's an issue regarding the accuracy, because he told the judge that he was appearing as a next friend to you. and he wasn't allowed to testify, and then he asked on the record if she had an oath of office, and she said yes, she acknowledged it, but he says he got the transcript, and that's not present. So even within that, there's an issue. And so I'm not as much looking for legal advice from you, but I'm pulling your coattail to it to say, hey, you know, we got some serious issues here. Yeah.
The administrative judge for the court, for the circuit court there, or the administrative office of the courts. I don't know who sets that rule and what the basis is for that.
Of course. And I will, like I say, as you know, every time I call, I do record for accuracy, and I will call them next. Okay, so she just told me to contact Judge Turnbull, which is what I'm doing now. Good afternoon. This is Christopher King. I'm with Mortgage Movies, and I've come across something that I'm confused by. There has been a series of ongoing administrative hearings regarding attorney censure with respect to Matthew McDowell and John Burson. These were publicly held hearings, and someone sent me the audio transcript from these hearings. However, I was told that I couldn't post them because they got a note from the Technical Services Department saying that these court proceedings are for the limited purposes of verification of testimony, and that any broadcast or copies made of them is strictly prohibited by law and administrative order of this court. And I need to know, that strikes me as unconstitutional. It was a public hearing, and so...
I have no idea what you're talking about. I can try to get some information for you, but I, off the top of my head, I have no clue.
Micky Norman was handpicked by John Lee, an attorney, who works in conjunction with Thomas P. Dorr and all those guys. He delivered a courtesy copy of a motion to dismiss to Judge Norman before he was even assigned to the case. Then, of course, Norman appears on the case. Now, he picked Judge Norman because, unlike Judges King or Karam, Judge Norman had not sanctioned attorney Thomas P. Dorr for misconduct and false documents and signatures in violation of Emergency Rule 14-207.1, as drafted by Senior Judge Alan Wilner and the committee, the Emergency Committee. Now, in essence, Mr. Wetzelberger and I knew that Judge Norman was a ringer who would do whatever the banks wanted him to do. And that's probably, in part because Dorr's law partner is a senator, spent a substantial amount of time as a state senator. Now, listen to a bit of the April 2013 court transcript that I published earlier, where we hear Judge Norman flip the burdens of proof to the homeowner to disprove his signature instead of the foreclosing attorney proving the signature. And he's also actively violating the law in another case where a homeowner should have been granted default judgment. But more on that in a coming video.
Knowledge of this when Mr. Dorr was in the stand, I would have presented this to him and said, Mr. Dorr, how can you explain that you claim to have a note, like the original from M&T Bank, when the Florida mortgage bankers in the Supreme Court stated all physical documents are, all physical notes are destroyed. They're not only destroyed, they're deliberately eliminated. So how can a physical, original, wet ink signature, authenticated note, which, mind you, there were two different copies entered into the 08 case and the 10 case, one with endorsement, one without. How can Mr. Dorr state that he has the original with credibility, confidence, or liability? It's impossible. Per the Florida mortgage bankers, and Mr. Dorr admitted he has no firsthand knowledge. Only I can authenticate. I'm not going to go back to that, but there's substantial contrary evidence that if I don't have it here somewhere in this transcript that says not my signature, I think I objected every other way I could have possibly done. Maybe I forgot to say it was my signature. It is not my signature. That note is not authenticated.
Well, that train has left the station. You had ample opportunity in a contested hearing to produce whatever evidence you wanted at the time concerning your signature.
So what all has Judge Norman done here? Well, as I mentioned, he flipped the burdens of proof, but he also ignored a motion to recuse. Didn't even address it in court. Okay, just went right on ahead. Furthermore, he tried to hide a court order dismissing Mr. Wetzelberger's prior filing. There was a counterclaim. There was an order out there from a judge, I believe it was Judge Cahill, that dismissed it because Mr. Wetzelberger had filed the counterclaim while there was an appeal pending. So that's a dismissal without prejudice, okay? But at some point, Judge Cahill, I think prior to that, had issued a dismissal with prejudice, but seeing the error of his ways, and we all know that constitutionally, you can't dismiss it with prejudice when you had no jurisdiction, okay? But yet and still, Judge Micky Norman uses this against Mr. Wetzelberger in an attempt to paint him as a vexatious litigant, okay? That's because he's dirty, he's corrupt, and the whole process is dirty and corrupt, okay? We all know, and any lawyer out there knows that you cannot predicate a dismissal with prejudice in a situation where you had no jurisdiction to ab initio, all right? So he can come after me all he wants to because he's full of shit. Now, the next point, to back it all up and to make sure that the American public never got any of this directly from the court, Norman threatened me with criminal contempt for running video. Meanwhile, his own clerks were busy Googling my name during the hearing in April, and they reneged on allowing me to video after initially saying that I could set up, and my notice of media coverage previously sent to the court was ignored. Okay? Now, had I been permitted to run the video, it would have shown John Lee put his head in his hands when Mr. Wetzelberger entered the 1099A into evidence, proving that he was not responsible for repayment of the alleged debt. Now, this is why Baltimore courts and other foreclosure fraudsters like John Burson and Matthew McDowell are always reading my mortgage movies journal. I put it out there in ways that the Baltimore Sun never will.
The next generation will be here.